Hello, everyone. This is Dr. Eberle welcoming you to MST's Black History Month celebration. It goes without saying, with us all experiencing these challenging times through the pandemic, we need to celebrate something important, relevant, and fun. Mr. Davis, our incredible music teacher, has created a wonderful production for all of us that I know you will all love. I wish to thank Mr. Davis for his outstanding work and thank all who have participated in this production. I hope you enjoy it. Stay safe and healthy. Have a wonderful day.
Only one way we're gonna start this night off. I wanna lead everyone tonight. Miami, join me. America, join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I chose Sojourner Truth, an African-American woman who was a woman's rights and abolitionist activist during the 1800s to shed light to Black history. Truth was born in a Dutch-speaking Ulster County, New York in 1797. She was born into slavery and originally called Isabella Bonfrey. Growing up, she was faced with unfair and harsh treatment. Truth was bought and sold 4 times as a slave. She met with another slave and had 5 children in the time span of 1815 to 1827. Later, she took her child Sophia to an abolitionist family called the Van Wagoners, whom bought her freedom and sued an illegal trade of slaves to return Truth's 5-year-old son to her. Truth moved to New York City in 1828 and started working for a local minister. Soon, she started giving religious speeches that gave her the title of a charismatic speaker. In 1843, Pomfrey changed her name to Sojourner Truth, saying she was called upon by a Holy Spirit to preach the truth. Truth met with many abolitionists such as William Lloyd Garrison and Frederick Douglass that inspired her to speak about the evils of slavery. Although Truth did not know how to read or write, she went on to create an autobiography called The Narrative of Sojourner Truth. In 1850, Olive Gilbert helped her publish her book and bought it national recognition. She met with Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony, whom were women's rights activists. In 1851, she started a tour in which she gave lectures on topics such as women's rights. There, she gave her famous Ain't I a Woman speech, where she addresses racial and gender equality by using herself as an example. She had a dispute with Douglass, and they separated because Douglass believed black men should be able to vote before women. During the 1850s, she settled down in Battle Creek, Michigan, where her daughters lived. She continued giving speeches to help slaves get their freedom around the nation. During the Civil War, Truth encouraged young men to join the Union, and she helped organize supplies for black troops. When the war ended, Truth was given the honor of an invitation to the White House. There, she helped freed slaves get employed and start a new life. She went on to fight against segregation and always stood up to anyone that treated her with disrespect. She did many more things to help African Americans live a steady life. Towards the end of her life, Truth was almost blind and deaf, and spent her last years in Michigan, and she died in 1883.
Well, children, where there is so much racket, there must be something out of kilter. I think that twixt the Negroes of the South and the women at the North, all talking about rights, white men will be in a fix pretty soon. But what's all this here talking about? That man over there says that women need to be helped into carriages, lifted over ditches, and to have the best place everywhere. Well, nobody ever helps me into a carriage or over a mud puddle or gives me the best place. And ain't I a woman? Look at me. Look at my arm. I have plowed and planted and gathered into bonds, and no man could head me. And ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man when I could get it and bear the lash as well. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children and seen most of all sold into slavery. And when I cried out with a mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. And ain't I a woman? And then they talk about this thing here, this thing in the head. What's that called? Intellect. Yes, that's it, honey. What's that got to do with women's rights or Negro rights? If my cup won't hold but a pint and yours would hold a quart, wouldn't you be mean not to give me my little half measure full? And then that little man in the black there, he says, women can't have rights because Christ wasn't a woman. Where did your Christ come from? From God and a woman. Man had nothing to do with that. If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, then these women together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again. And now, they is asking to do it. And the men better let them. obliged to you for hearing me. Now, old Sojourner ain't got nothing more to say.
You lied, just said to me. Don't you be a meanie. Thought you wanted me to go. Or why you tryna keep me teeny now? Now they need me. Number one, I'm screaming. Oh, yeah, you.
I'm losing my religion. Thank God I prayed about my decision. How odd for the man with the mic to be the man all his life while Christ-like Stipes did with REM, rev up the RPMs. How do I begin to try to paint this sin of rules that divides God's people in two? In the beginning, religion created a mass. The Reformation helped, but the patch didn't last. I don't tell, you don't ask. So we created a lie. And for generations, church is where we went to go high. Or we no longer tried. Because rules without relationship is empty inside. Leaves you bitter, dry, swift to cut like a razor. Swift to call you a traitor. Cause you're swift to love Taylor. Now we got bad blood with our neighbor. Who's wrong? Who's right? Every Sunday we're divided. Who's black? Who's white? Shimon. Now the man in the mirror never gets race right. He'll never be Christ-like. Never receive good pay, so your faith never rises above minimum wage. So when it's time to save the world, you don't know what to say to the brother that you love when he tells you he's gay. Do you push him away? Judge him down till he leaves? Give him a gospel he hears or a gospel he sees? Love wrapped in truth is the gospel he needs. There's room at the cross for everyone, even me. Well, my sins are now clean. The lost are redeemed. Religion is a prison, but truth sets us free. Help us believe that the world we're now in is not the world that will be. Terror, famine, disease, millions in poverty, hungry, can't sleep. With all these religions, why these babies can't eat? And if the middle class is gone, how can America see? How can America breathe when the oxygen is gone from the American dream? And these American streets, listen close as they speak. The next time you think America, please include me. Help the ones that are weak. All they want is a piece of the pie that you keep. Is that too much to ask for those who laid the concrete, still laying on concrete, pop, pop, by the police? See, they the foundation of the nation, not the 2%. Not the ones who own the buildings that the middle class rent. Tell me how you feel. I'm the new Franklin. I have the new deal. I fight to do right. FDR for real. One nation under God. God, show us the way. The science of opinion. God is not a buffet. You pick what you want, so no God on your plate. The preacher isn't God. Religion's first mistake. Serving stewards, shepherds, not kings, has to die to his flesh every day like me. One VIP. All the other seats in church are free. We're just groupies. God is the celebrity. Before 313 AD, before Constantine, before the Council of Nicaea, before Greeks and Romans, before Calvin, Alexander, Luther, before Let There Be, before history, to the last century, before the death on the tree, before the fall of man, was a picture of me nailed to his heart right before the last three words he would speak. It is finished. Can you believe? I'm losing my religion. Thank God. Helping you lose yours is my job.
Now the war is not over. Who am I? Why am I here? If my brothers and sisters were the mistakes, and every breath we take is evil, why were we placed? For goodness sake, white plaster walls are more than I can take. Confined in this loop of hate with no escape, am I to blame? Am I to blame for all the pain that none of us seem to contain? We throw fists out of rage, pop off guns at parades, and fight in masquerades. Because they say we're the mistakes, we're to blame for everything. The walls that confine us, the shiny white view that spews its shameful lust onto us, it constantly beats us and leaves us to think that the little black dot in the plaster room of white was its mistake.
Sell their products both at home and abroad. The more we sell abroad, the more higher paying jobs we provide here at home. It's that simple.
So what you're saying is this trade deal will help put everyday Americans back to
work, 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 work. Put it back to work, 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 work. You put it back to
work, 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 work.
Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
The children of our children, by the time they have grown, have habits like rabbits and young of their own. The children of children, from their mama's lap, hop down to the ground to be taken in traps. The children of our children are trapped by dark skins to stay in and playing a game no one wins. The children of our children, while still young and sweet, are damned and programmed for future defeat. The children of our children are trapped by adults who jail them and fail them to hide the results. The children of children, unable to cope with systems that twist them and rob them of hope. The children of our children, with the sin and the shame, keep bearing and pairing. And who do they blame? The children of our children cry out every day. They beg you for rescue. And what do you say? Speak life twice. Project wit, wisdom in troubled time. That's our answer.
Last year, we had the pleasure of hosting Mrs. Irene Taylor McVay, student activist, civil rights foot soldier, and educator in our building at MST. Irene Taylor and her best friend Barbara Johns grew up in rural Virginia. In 1951, they were seniors at Robert Russo Mountain High School in Farmville, Virginia. Their buses, schools, theaters, water fountains, and society were segregated. Inspired by the lessons their parents, pastors, and peers taught them, they decided it was time to challenge the long-standing doctrine of separate but equal. Their humble efforts inspired the modern student civil rights movement. Taylor and Johns organized the first student-led, nonviolent walkout protesting segregation in the United States. Immediately, their parents supported their movement. Soon thereafter, the NAACP took up the mantle of their case. Taylor and John's walkout predated the Montgomery bus boycott, Rosa Parks' arrest, the lynching of Emmett Till, the integration of the Little Rock Public Schools, the sit-ins at Woolworths, the Freedom Riders, and it reignited the modern civil rights movement. The goal of their walkout was to end segregation in Prince Edward County Public Schools, and they succeeded. In 1954, Taylor and John's walkout was one of the five cases heard as part of the landmark Supreme Court case, Brown versus Board of Education of Topeka. Taylor and John's plan was well orchestrated and coordinated. While the principal was out of the building, Barbara Johns commandeered the PA system and called the entire school to the auditorium where she informed her classmates and teachers, with Irene Taylor by her side, of their plans to protest segregation. The students picketed their own school for the rest of the day, carrying signs that read, "Down with tar paper shacks," and "We want a new school or none at all." The Farmville 11 met with the superintendent the next day. During their conversations, the superintendent threatened to put all the parents in jail. Barbara Johns responded, "There's not a jail in the whole county that can hold us all." After the walkout, schools remained closed throughout the end of the academic year. Many seniors did not graduate, despite the local churches holding classes in lieu of their public schools being closed. Thurgood Marshall held a series of community forums in the Prince Edward County School District in preparation for an NAACP-led Supreme Court challenge to the separate but equal doctrine. Unknown to Taylor and Johns, their humble steps to fight segregation helped change the course of American history. The unanimous final decision of the Brown versus Board of Education ruled, "Segregation of white and colored children in public schools has a detrimental effect upon the colored children. Separate educational facilities are inherently unequal." After this milestone decision, the Supreme Court ruled that separating children in public schools on the basis of race was unconstitutional. It signaled the end of legalized segregation in the schools of the United States, and also made equal opportunity in education the law of the land. After high school, Irene Taylor moved to Buffalo to start her career. She married Jim McVay in 1959 after meeting him at St. Luke AME Zion Church. Together they had four children, Janet, James, Joy, and Jeffrey. Now Irene McVay started working for the Buffalo Public Schools. During her time working for the Buffalo Public Schools, she hosted assemblies celebrating Black History Month. She also organized an assembly commemorating Dr. King's life while celebrating his legacy after his assassination. This program, known as Keeping the Dream Alive Assembly, traveled with Ms. McVay when she moved to School 17 and ultimately City Honors, and continues to this day. Throughout the year, she coordinated history challenges every February. Each morning, they were asked a question about important African Americans or historical events. Her tireless contributions to the Buffalo Public Schools earned her the distinction of Teacher's Aide of the Year in 1989. She retired from Buffalo Public Schools in 2005, but in retirement continued to serve the children of Buffalo as a volunteer. Reflecting on her lifetime of struggle for equality through education, Mrs. McVay reminded future student leaders that it never stops. You have to keep going. As a student activist, an educator in Buffalo Public Schools, and as a volunteer in retirement, McVay fought inequity her entire life and firmly believes that there is no such thing as separate and equal. Either we work together or we are never going to be equal. Thank you, Ms. McVay.
Thank you. Alamar, Shalamar, Swanee Shaw. Let me dig this jam once more, boy.
Right on down to the gate.
Oh, boy.
Gotta dig my little gate.
Now, can't you hear those hepcats call? Come on, boys, let's have a ball. The jim jam jump, it, the jumping jive makes you dig your jive on the mellow side. Hep, hep. Hep, hep. Jim jump is a solid jive, makes you 9 foot tall when you're 4 foot five. Hip, hip. Hip, hip. Now don't you be that ickaroo, get hip, come on, and then you follow through. You get your study full, you make up the jolly jump of the like of the gators do. Jim jam jump is a jumping jive, makes you like your eggs on the jersey side. Hip, hip. Hip, hip. Jim Jim jumping jive makes you a hep hep on the mahala side. Tibbly bully bully biddly bumpity goodly giddly bang 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 tang di da da. Now I've told you about the jumping jive. Jim Jim jump the jumping jive. You got to dig this mellow jive. Yes, yes, you dig it on the mellow side. A bully 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 boy.
A bully bully
boy. A bully bully
gay.
A bully bully gay. A bully bully gay. A bully gay. Time boy. Coin tika kank di bump bump a seedle that the pot.
Colleges are spaces where Black people are affirmed.
You could be yourself and develop yourself in this rich soil.
It's a space that is an unapologetic Black space.
These are places where there's incredible freedom to explore.
Before the Civil War, discrimination against black students led to the founding of the first black colleges in the North, including Wilberforce in Ohio and Lincoln and Cheney Universities in Pennsylvania.
Cheney University in Philadelphia is the first historically black college or university. It was founded in 1837 as the Institute of Colored Youth. The founding of that institution transforms educational possibility for African American people.
The era saw huge growth in the number of black colleges and universities, from Howard and Fisk to Hampton and Tuskegee.
Historically, black colleges and universities take African Americans who struggle in our failing public schools and turn them into a rigorous scholar with access to a future who has earned the credentials for a college degree.
HBCUs arose as a direct response to racial discrimination, providing opportunities for black students to gain a higher education and enter the middle class.
Today, all 101 HBCUs across the United States continue to play a vital role in America's prosperity, academically, socially, and economically. Many notable Black Americans have attended HBCUs, including Vice President Kamala Harris, who attended Howard University, Oprah Winfrey, who attended Tennessee State University, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who attended Morehouse College, the first Black U.S. Supreme Court Justice, Thurgood Marshall, who attended Lincoln University and Howard University, and NFL Hall of Famer and TV host Michael Strahan, who attended Texas Southern University. Although HBCUs were originally founded to educate Black Americans, today one in four students, which is 24%, enrolled at HBCUs is non-Black.
I met you in the dark, you lit me up. You made me feel as though I was enough. We danced the night away. We drank too much. I held your hair back when you were throwing up. Then you smiled over your shoulder. For a minute I was stone cold sober. I pulled you closer to my chest, and you asked me to stay over. I said I already told you. I think that you should get some rest. I knew I loved you then. Never know. I wanna live with you until we're gray and old. I know I needed you, but I'll never show you. I wanna stay with you until we're gray and old. Just say you won't let go. Just say you won't let go. I'll wake you up with some breakfast in bed. I'll bring you coffee with a kiss on your head. I'll take the kids to school, wave them goodbye, and I'll thank my lucky stars for that night. When you look over your shoulder, for a minute I forget that I'm older. I wanna dance with you right now. Oh, you look as beautiful as ever, and I swear that every day you get better. You made me feel this way somehow. I knew I needed you, but I'll never show. I wanna stay with you until we're gray and old. I knew I needed you, but I'll never show. I wanna stay with you until we're strain on.
My love has no beginning, my love has no end, no front or back, my love won't bend. I'm in the middle, lost in a spin, loving you. And you don't know how glad I am. My love has no bottom, my love has no top. My love won't rise, my love won't drop. I'm in the middle, can't stop loving you. You don't know how glad I am. I wish I were a poet so I could express what I'd like to say. Yeah. And you don't know, you don't know, you don't know, you don't know how glad I am. No, you don't, no, you don't, no, you don't, no, you don't know how glad I am. How glad I am. How glad I am. How so shocked before. I headed blindly through the door. They didn't see me passing through. Guess who I saw today? Guess who I saw today? Guess who I saw today?
Thank you. saw millions of migrating birds flying over today. Couldn't tell which were leading and showing the others the way. But I thought as I watched them sail by, extending for miles to the sky, what a blessing it must be to fly with a column of birds. They were soaring in search of the source of some almighty force, all adrift in the drafts of the winds, without altering course. Gripped by gravity here on the ground, I wondered where they might be bound, where the site of their search would be found by this column of birds. And how did they get it together to take off as one and go race? This column of birds of a feather off to some better place. How did they make the connection? How did they come to agree to fly in a single direction toward not what one of them could see. They were going and going and going and going and gone to the oncoming night, to the brightness of some distant dawn. As I turned and went back to my plow, to the grind of the grim here and now, I wished our kind would take off somehow, like a column of birds. Column of birds. Column of birds, 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 birds. Thank you.